You're listening to Economics Detective Radio. Returning to the podcast today is Samuel Hammond. He's a policy analyst at the Niskanen Center. Sam, welcome back to Economics Detective Radio.
Thanks for having me, Garrett.
So last time we talked about supersonic air travel. This time we're going to be talking about something very different. In this case, it's Pepsi, a specific aspect of Pepsi, in fact. So back in April, we had one of these controversy of the weeks, and it centered around a Pepsi ad that featured Kendall Jenner and some hipster protesters drinking Pepsi and sharing them with riot police. But Sam did something I like, which was took this, sort of flash in the pan controversy of the week and made it a teachable moment. So Sam, why don't you tell me a little bit about Pepsi? Let's start with this ad. Why did it upset some people?
Well, for anyone who forgets, the ad basically featured this generic protest of a group of young people, and with the camera flashing back and forth to show that they were of different mixed race, different religion. So it was just like multicultural group of people marching down the street for a cause that was really not defined. The signs just said stuff like "join the conversation." And then it culminated with Kendall Jenner, who's apparently a celebrity, in a photo shoot, seeing the protest march by. She becomes inspired by it. It's kind of like the symbolic woke awakening. Like, she became woke all of a sudden by this protest. She rips off her wig, throws it into the arms of her black assistant, and then enters the protest. And then it finishes with them approaching a police line, and Kendall Jenner walks up to the police officer and hands him a can of Pepsi, which he cracks open, and the crowd goes wild. And I guess the take-home message is that Pepsi, it brings harmony and ends police violence. So for kind of obvious reasons, there was this big backlash to this ad, because I even tweeted at the time that this is just like ridiculous. It was, in some people's terms, it was co-opting the resistance. Another more general impression was it was just plain insensitive to like Black Lives Matter. And I don't really dispute any of that in my piece. I agree that the ad was kind of poorly executed, but I kind of wanted to put it within the context of a deeper history of like corporate advertising, where they're using images of social justice and embedding those same themes normally with better execution, and to defend that practice in general. And as you said, using it as a teachable moment.
Yeah. So you flash back all the way back to 1940. Today, we see Pepsi as one of the two giants of the sugary drink industry, along with Coke. But in 1940, it was basically only Coke. Pepsi was selling just a tiny fraction of the number of sodas Coke had, and they had this new CEO, Walter S. Mack Jr. So tell me about Mack Jr. and what his strategy was to catch up to Coke.
So Walter Mack Jr. was an interesting guy. In the 1940s, he described himself as both a progressive but also an unrepentant capitalist. And so for a lot of social justice warrior types, it's hard to square that. But I think what he actually did with Pepsi and how he grew Pepsi sort of illustrates the combination of capitalism with social justice. And so what he did was, you know, he was in the shadow of this behemoth, this Coca-Cola behemoth. And he noticed that at the time, people systematically underserved African Americans, whether it was through direct product creation and selling to African communities, or just in the labor market as well. And so he saw that as resonating both with his capitalist side and with his progressive side. And what he realized was, you know, if we market Pepsi directly to this underserved market segment, then we can actually get a foothold in the market and potentially grow. And that's what happened. They became the number two Pepsi. And it all sort of goes back to his decision to hire Edward Boyd. And Edward Boyd was one of the first African-American ad executives and is considered the father of niche marketing, or one of the fathers, at least. And Boyd developed these sort of remarkable ads featuring middle-class Black families sitting around the dinner table with Pepsi on the table. And it represented African-American families in a way that was totally outside the norm of the time. It really normalized those kind of families as regular middle-class families. And in addition to the advertising, Pepsi hired a huge team of African-American sales representatives who would travel around the country going to the different communities and basically selling product. And as I mentioned in the piece, you know, at the time, it was really abnormal to see a African-American gentleman walking down the road in a business suit with a briefcase. It was just not the public perception of the kind of jobs that a black person should be able to have. And so at the time, Walter Mack would hire them black cars with tinted windows so they would avoid harassment. And part of my argument is that by seeing that market opportunity, by seeing this underserved market segment, Pepsi both advanced the cause of social justice, the cause of bringing a minority and marginalized group into the mainstream while making money.
Yeah. And if any TV executives are listening, that Edward F. Boyd, he's sort of the black Don Draper, really would be a good idea to maybe pitch a TV show based on him. I think I would watch it and enjoy it more than Mad Men. It's just a really interesting story. Let's talk a little bit about why a big company would want to do this. You touched on it a little in your while talking about it, that there was this underserved market segment, and Pepsi sort of pioneered this idea of niche marketing. There must have been a benefit on the labor side, too, hiring these African-American ad men and salespeople, because, of course, if they were not getting hired to regular jobs at the time, you could potentially hire them for less than their marginal product. Do you know if that was the case?
Yeah, I think it was a perfect real-life example of Gary Becker's theory of discrimination. So Gary Becker, famous economist, he's really well known for sort of taking economic ways of thinking and applying them to social phenomena as opposed to just money and markets. And his dissertation work was on the economics of discrimination. And he sort of revolutionized people's way of thinking about discrimination by sort of thinking of it in terms of supply and demand. And the basic idea is this: if you have a population of people, let's say, and this is not a super hypothetical, let's say black people were being systematically discriminated against in the labor market. In theory, what that does is it takes labor that is equally productive to white European labor in terms of like their ability to construct advertising and to be creative. So if you're a company that is out there and sees that, you can then go hire those people and have a market advantage. So one way of thinking about Gary Becker's theory is that competitive markets punish taste-based discrimination. So discrimination that's just purely based on not merit, but just pure taste, because we don't like a certain minority group, that sort of discrimination gets punished by the market because it can give competitors a systematic edge to sort of defect from the culture that is discriminating against folks. And over time, that discount, so you know, over time, the discounted population becomes bid back up and they become, again, mainstreamed, right? So that's the general theory. And there are some exceptions to Becker's ideas. One of the big distinctions he made was between post-market and pre-market activity. So you could have post-market discrimination is the sort of thing we're talking about, but pre-market, there could be forms of discrimination, like in terms of disadvantaged education systems, disadvantaged family structures, and so on, which could impact the actual productivity of a minority population, which is sort of why Gary Becker's work has inspired a lot of people in the, you know, school choice movement. You know, if we could introduce competition, the earlier you introduce competition, the earlier you can rid out that sort of arbitrary form of discrimination.
Yeah, there are examples of this playing out in apartheid South Africa, where there were construction companies that the owners of them were white and presumably racist. And there were laws against hiring black construction workers. But on the other hand, there was money on the table. There was money to be gained by hiring these black construction workers at a discount. And so even though the employers were racist in this case, they liked money more than they liked discriminating. And that became a way for black South Africans to earn money and to compete in the labor market. In this case, it was a semi-illegal labor market because of the laws against employing them.
Right. And so this idea is just that money is a kind of great leveler. And commerce is a great leveler. A good businessman will recognize if he structures his business based on his particular tastes, that over time that business will stumble and fail. You're constantly, as a business person, trying to adapt to the actual market. And coming in with a lot of prejudice is not actually a good way to succeed in business.
Yeah, yeah. And this all ties in with something you talk about in your essay, which is the do-commerce thesis. That's D-O-U-X. It's a French word for like soft and fluffy. And it's the idea that commerce makes us better people. It's really a hypothesis. And people have tried to test this in various contexts, but talk about that a little. Does commerce make us better, in a sense?
I think so. Now, one way to think about commerce and trade is that it just puts people into a mutually beneficial relationship. I think it was Robert Wright who said, one reason we don't bomb Japan today is because they build our cars. And so there's a way in which the material facts of economic trade trickle down to or trickle up to cultural and normative ideas. And in terms of commerce, I think the idea of due commerce is basically that, you know, commerce puts us in an exchange relationship where we're treating each other as equally dignified agents. It situates you in that sort of context. And, you know, this was a hypothesis that sort of developed out of the Industrial Revolution from just observation. People were noting that, you know, the Dutch, who had extensive trading and commerce, were more trustworthy. It wasn't just that they were richer, but they also had a whole host of positive side effects in terms of virtues and normative relationships that were downstream of the simple fact of trading.
And I think we should, to listeners who are maybe not totally on board with our way of looking at the world, this might seem strange because, of course, we always talk about competition in markets, and you might think, and in some ways, markets are very cutthroat, right? Bill Gates trying to take down Netscape or, you know, Pepsi and Coke, they're sort of at each other's throats in a sense, they're trying to get market share. But the other side of markets is that why are Pepsi and Coke competing? They're competing to cooperate with their consumers to sell them sugary drinks in this case. So that's the idea. You may be competing with the other firms in your industry, but you're cooperating with your suppliers and with your customers at the same time. And that gives you an incentive to be nice and trustworthy and just sort of good in different ways.
Yeah, and that's a sort of dichotomy that comes up in my piece, where I discuss how, you know, markets both reward and punish different types of conformity. You know, so in the case of the due commerce thesis, there is a tendency, like when you go on a business trip to a foreign country where you are on your best behavior, you are being respectful of the other person's culture. There is an equal recognition through the handshake that seals the deal. So in some sense, that's promoting a kind of cooperative conformity. You're conforming to certain expectations of good behavior. On the other hand, when Pepsi went out and did the niche marketing that grew their business, they were actually defecting against a prevailing norm. They were subverting that norm effectively. And so the question is, how do those two forces of conformity and nonconformity add up? And my tendency, or the way I come down on this, is that thinking about Gary Becker's non-discrimination model, it kind of moves in one direction. So you can have a situation where there is a people that are systematically discriminated against, but as soon as someone defects from that sort of normative equilibrium and breaks with the culture, they will have a permanent competitive edge unless everyone else sort of follows along. So you sort of can sort of think of this in terms of like the Moneyball phenomena. If you've ever watched the movie Moneyball, these sabermetrics guys come in and they figure out that if we're focusing on the wrong stats for baseball players, so if we pick different discounted players, we can build a pretty powerful team without a big budget. And so, you know, that's how the Athletic A's famously, you know, had that really good year. But since then, that edge has sort of disappeared in the statistics. It seems like now we're back to where the Yankees and the Red Sox have figured out they were using the wrong stats and they've adjusted. Something really similar happens, I think, in the market, where you can have marginalized groups that are uncatered to for quite a long time. But as soon as they're brought into the fold, it ends up becoming a kind of ratchet effect where they will never again be out of the fold. and in fact, it builds on itself.
Yeah, yeah. You use some other examples of niche marketing. You have a section in your essay called Social Justice as an Intangible Asset, where you talk about Subaru. So tell me first, what is an intangible asset in this context, and how does Subaru play into it?
So an intangible asset just is distinct from a physical asset, like a warehouse or something like that. And there's been this general phenomena within the stock market where more and more of the stock market's value, the total market cap of the stock market, seems to be shifting out of physical capital into intangible capital or intangible assets. And that might include brand and reputation and stuff like that. So, you know, a really clear case of this in Subaru is how Subaru built a car brand around catering to gay and lesbian communities. So, you know, now you can turn on Family Guy and you'll hear jokes about like a lesbian driving a Subaru. Where does that come from? Well, it came from the 90s in the midst of Don't Ask, Don't Tell and sort of this kind of repressive, oppressive culture. Subaru went ahead and decided to directly market their Outbacks and other vehicles to a lesbian audience. The way they did this was kind of clever. They embedded subtextual hints within their advertising. So an example that I use in my piece is this ad that shows two Outbacks side by side, and you have to look at the license plates. The license plates say Camp Out, and the other one says Xena, as a reference to Xena Warrior Princess. You know, if you were a homophobe looking at that ad, you would just see two cars. But if you're a lesbian who feels a little bit persecuted in the mainstream culture, you see a company that is reaching out to you and building something for your tastes and for the sort of activities and preferences that you have. And that draws you to that company. And so Subaru did that. Nowadays, we have, you know, Modern Family and shows. Gay and lesbian communities have become fully integrated into the mainstream. And I think this is another case of Subaru being the first person or the first group to really defect, and that defection giving them an edge, which led downstream to this ratcheting effect where more and more a marginalized community was brought into the fold.
I mean, it's hard to say. I think there's some causation there, right? It took a Pepsi marketing to Black people, a Subaru marketing to LGBT people that helped accelerate things or maybe cause things. It wasn't just that they were getting ahead of the curve. It was that in some ways they were pushing the curve. They were bringing marginalized groups into the fold by making them part of consumer capitalist sort of culture.
And now we're seeing it again play out with like the trans community, right? We have shows like Transparent that feature a middle-aged man's transition into being a woman.
And also Sense8 on Netflix features a trans character. It's not about being trans. They're just trans, and that's that. It's a science fiction show. I really enjoyed it.
Right. Yeah, and so that's sort of the pinnacle of this process where something becomes so mainstream that it's not like the point of, it's not like something that's a salient issue for that character. They just happen to be trans. And I think that there's a causation in both directions. There's the idea that like creating a show about a middle-aged man's transition is both only possible because we've come so far, but it also continues to advance what people, the public's perception about these issues.
So we've talked a lot about niche marketing, targeting a specific group. The other thing you talk about in your essay is the total market approach, which is sort of the opposite, but related. Tell me about the total market approach.
So a total market approach, like if a niche market strategy is sort of targeting one segment of the market, say African-American or lesbian, the total market approach is trying to sell it to as many people as possible, and therefore trying to embed images and ideas that can connect with as large a swath of people as you can. And so this is why you see this trend of advertising where, you know, in the case of the Pepsi ad, where people were of every single race and gender and religious background were all represented, or in the case of that famous Super Bowl ad from 2014, where America the Beautiful was sung in seven different languages. So, you know, the reason for this approach, in the early days, Pepsi may have been small, and so then they wanted to leverage a niche market to get entry into the larger market. But now that Pepsi is a giant and Coca-Cola is a giant, they're really well served by reaching out to as many people as they can. And this has some trade-offs, of course. Like niche products are always going to be inherently a little more richer, a little more interesting, a little more catered to a particular like aesthetic. And a very like total market approach to advertising is always going to seem a little bit more generic, a little bit more homogenized. So part of my piece is to say, you can look at this as a lowest common denominator or a highest common denominator. One way of thinking about a theory of justice and social justice is to think about what are the set of rules that can cover the most plural society. And those rules include things like tolerance and pluralism and celebrating diversity and dialogue and conversation. All these things have become sort of cliche, but they're also totally congruent with effective marketing. So, you know, my claim is that we can critique the homogenizing elements of that total market approach or that generic element. I agree it's not totally aesthetically rich as something that is like very niche, but it has some salutary properties because it sort of embeds and embodies pluralism and inclusion.
You talk about Orientalism. In the past, a lot of the time when you'd see other cultures in media, they would be sort of caricatures or even sort of making fun of them. And you talk about how in this age of globalization and international supply chains and international business, we've really gone a long way towards reducing Orientalism. Today, movies and such sell to global markets, and creators of, you know, these corporations and also the population in general are just more aware of how people on the opposite side of the globe live than they were in the past.
Right. The way Bud Light put it in one ad was that labels belong on beer, not on people, which I think is wonderful. Yeah. So the same trends that can happen within a country can also happen between countries and between cultures. And I think that there's a lot to celebrate in globalization from how trade and commerce between radically different peoples and nations has sort of lifted the fog on those cultures and really shown, you know, really put us into, again, that due commerce sort of hypothesis relationship where we see some common cause or we share some common end together in this bilateral cooperative sort of dynamic. And I think Orientalism is a perfect case. Orientalism sort of refers to this notion of portraying the foreign as the exotic. And there's something very exploitative about that. You know, when Alanis Morissette went to India and, you know, bathed in the Ganges and then came back and wrote a song about it, there's a sense in which she's patronizing and being condescending to this other culture in a way that a company going into India and setting up bilateral trade relationships isn't. In my view, that latter option requires of you, it puts sort of export discipline on you to understand the culture in a way that's genuine and not this kind of exotic tourist sort of thing. And so what are some downstream implications of that? Well, maybe we shouldn't get so hung up about cultural appropriation. You know, cultural appropriation, all that means is exchange and admixture of different cultural ideas. Quentin Tarantino is famous for adopting and adapting the Hong Kong style action movie, the Kung Fu movie. And there's equal and opposite sort of cultural creations going on the other side of the world where things that are conventionally thought of as Western are being adopted and adapted and made something new out of them. And I kind of like that. Frankly, I kind of like the idea of like producing, we can have local cultures and global cultures at the same time. And for the same reasons, the same argument I made about like the homogenizing effect at the national level with like Coke and Pepsi and the total market approach, when there's a global culture forming, it's going to have to appeal to things that can resonate across the world. And messages of pluralism and love and toleration are some of those ideas that resonate.
I like what you had to say about global business. I think it's telling that if you are writing a story about diversity or racial toleration between different ethnic groups, often you'll go and grab a stock photo of a person of color's hand shaking a white hand. And it's become so cliche now, but really does say a lot symbolically because, you know, a handshake, what does it symbolize? A meeting of the minds, a deal for mutual benefit, an agreement. And it's also tied with business, right? You don't ordinarily shake hands with your friends or your spouse. You shake hands with a business partner, someone you're going to make a deal with. And on another note related to due commerce and global capitalism bringing different cultures together. Back in April, I visited Korea, and I went to the demilitarized zone and took 2 steps into the north and then went right back. It's telling that the Vietnam War was more recent than the Korean War, but the difference is that Vietnam did not close itself off from markets and global trade, whereas North Korea did. And which country today is still chafing with the rest of the world, which country is still in conflict with everyone else, it's the one that closed itself off from trade. It's North Korea, not Vietnam, not still nominally communist China. China's effectively not been communist since the 1980s, and if you're wondering why they keep making Transformers movies, even though people in North America aren't really going to see them all that much, it's because they're making them to sell to Chinese teenagers. So tell me, you end your article talking about hashtag NLSJ. What's that?
So NLSJ, it stands for Neoliberal Social Justice. And, you know, part of this is a bit of a project to like reclaim the word neoliberal. I don't really want to get into a big discussion of the origins of that term or what it means, but it's used as an epithet for basically people who value global markets and globalization and capitalism in general. And there's a lot of ways you can think about and defend capitalism. You could defend it based on, you know, some principle of liberty, or you could base it on the consequences of wealth creation and lifting people out of poverty. I would think of those as, at least the latter, as being economic justice, which is certainly relevant. But these days, there's a lot of people interested in the idea of social justice, which includes things like cultural inclusion and non-discrimination. And so the NLSJ hashtag is for tagging things that we come across on Twitter of like instances of corporations sort of aligning the profit motive with an idea of social justice. So a good example is Uber. They're much reviled now, but you know, Uber has this program for reintegrating ex-offenders who otherwise have a lot of difficulty finding work after they get out of prison. And they're doing this again on sort of the Becker model, because they are a kind of underserved population that they can actually make money by reemploying, but they're also doing it because they recognize the injustice of a criminal record being something that follows you for life, is particularly if it's for something nonviolent like drug use. And, you know, they've done something very similar too for veterans who have difficulty finding employment. This idea sort of comes from a group of us online. That's why we have the hashtag. And I got to give credit to Rory Elwood for, I think, one of the more seminal pieces on this, where he discusses Mattel's decision to create a feminist Barbie with blue hair and curvy hips instead of like the patriarchal classic Barbie that is like this ideal of beauty that no one really lives up to. And that Barbie, when that came out, got a ton of flack. It got a ton of flack because people thought it was a cynical move to try to rewrite Barbie's past and like make her look like a normal woman instead of this like unrealistic ideal. But Rory's point is, look, social justice causes are far more likely to succeed when they ally with capitalism than when they oppose capitalism. And I think that's just the take-home message of the neoliberal social justice idea, that we should be celebrating when companies adopt and embed these things, because just like we want discrimination to be punished in the marketplace, we want social justice issues to be rewarded. So we're a small but growing movement, is what I say. And I think the underlying idea is that commercial culture and global capitalism have a telos, and that points towards social justice.
My guest today has been Sam Hammond. Sam, thanks for being part of Economics Detective Radio.
Thanks, Garrett.